I don't recall hearing about the smaller trees. You just added a new pine tree, that's fine. Some of those pine trees look pretty dead. But all of the smaller trees that are on the Marinwood property space, originally the building was going to be right on top of them, and they were going to destroy Eric's view, eliminate the beautiful view of trees. Has that been changed, or are there still going to be?
Yes, we're keeping the trees, and we will, again, this will be also.
You're going to consider not taking down as many of those small trees, okay. What about the oleanders that are all along?
Are oleanders a native plant that should be concerned?
There's a whole bunch of beautiful, tall, big, flowerful oleanders. Are those going to be taken down?
Where are you talking about? On the north side along the front path?
No, on the west end, on the very west end of your courtyard.
The west end of the courtyard?
Just outside.
I don't think they're in the.
All along the fence.
Near the horseshoe pit.
Opposite the horseshoe pit.
One second.
On the other side.
None of these trees, none of the small trees were ever proposed to be removed, and I think I talked extensively about that. I'm not sure, Linda, where you're talking about smaller trees.
Well, if you go over to the left, the left picture.
By the horseshoe pits.
Yeah.
The left picture, they're almost the same. Okay, right along the other side of the driveway from the horseshoe pits.
There's a line of, I believe, oleanders down here that are further down that wouldn't be touched, as far as I know. There's a bunch of, right next to the horseshoe pits and where that tree is being removed, so I.
Okay, well, I hadn't heard anything about what's going to be really chopped down, but I wanted to make sure those oleanders were going to stay there. The other thing is, now that you've moved the inner columns so that you're going to have a 20-foot width inside, what Mr. Hansel told us last month was that from the outside of the building, from north to south, from the outside, the building, not the courtyards, is 36 inches. So if you have a 20-foot innards, does that mean your columns are going to be 6 or 7 feet from the walls? Because if it's, so you're going to have columns really, really close to the walls.
Well, at some point, as you start to move columns here, they get closer to the walls. So, to Irv's point, if there's further study with the structural engineer going forward, to be able to eliminate those or find other ways to, to deal with
okay,
columns.
Okay, so those are what possibly.
At a certain point, we're going to need columns.
Okay, and then the other thing is there any kind of guarantee that the trucks coming from the east end, the materials yard on the east, will not drive all the way down into the meadow to turn around?
Yeah, we looked at that. We stood out on the site with Luke and Eric and myself, and it's not necessary to drive to the meadow to turn around the trucks.
Okay, because I was thinking that the corner of that east materials fenced area is very close to the creek. I mean, it's like, what?
Well, it's significantly further away from the creek than the existing building. So
it's
when the existing building is moved, there will be land there.
Is fill, and there's not a lot of space.
Well, if that land currently has materials stored all over it and has a tractor that parks in here and moves all around in this space. So once that's gone, that space is drivable. It's not so close to the top of the bank that it's
so, okay, so you
strength.
Do think
so,
that there will be,
those
will be able to turn around rather than backing out or however it's going to work. Okay, and the only other thing is, I have read and have heard from people about our assets, our trucks, our equipment, our little gopher busters or whatever they are, your little trucks and things. I've heard that a lot of times, if these are left out in the elements all day, all night, forever and ever and ever, they degrade a lot faster, so we lose money. Why isn't anybody thinking about that? Why are we going to have a whole bunch of storage that's going to be out in the open with the torrential rains in the winter, the raccoons, the squirrels, the bats, the birds, the rats, all of this crap coming on top of all of our assets. These are community assets. We don't want to keep replacing them.
The community assets will be covered in this design.
Excuse me?
The community assets will have a cover in this design.
The left hand?
The green area will be, yes.
Well, the center building, yes. But I'm talking about the left-hand side, the western end, which is the courtyard, that's going to be completely open.
Yes, but as you work during the day, you don't necessarily want to park your equipment during the day back and forth, right? You want to be more efficient in your...
Oh, well, that's fine, sure, when you're using the vehicles,
right.
Yes.
So to address your point, rest assured the vehicles will be stored with a coverage over them. That's why we have the roof.
Now you're saying that the western courtyard is not going to be used for vehicle storage at night. It's all going to be shoved into the covered building. I don't think that's possible. I don't think there's enough room for the seven.
All right, let me take a shot. Good luck. Thank you. Moving the columns aside, trying to increase the maneuverability in this space.
Yeah, need to, for sure.
I believe you would be able to pull in the truck is not something. These are not going to come in and have nice parking spaces with a big drive aisle lot left. Everything is going to have to be taken into that space, and yes, it is going to have to be shoehorned in. The reason why it's going to be shoehorned in is because the only other option would be to increase the square footage, which everybody I believe would have a problem with, or to extend the roof coverage beyond the area that it's already been restricted to.
And why can't you?
Okay, if I can finish. If you just look at it in terms of there's a big box here, right? This is the covered existing shed of the portion of this pink
land,
right? All of this other area, understanding that this is not defined by a fence, but it still has parking there, or whether you argue parking next to the trailer. All of that other area is totally exposed. So that's the current square footage that's
then look at how rusty the trucks
are. I can just finish it. So take that square and look at that square compared to essentially the workshop area, right? So the enclosed area currently is essentially being replicated, not increased, but it's being replicated. What is being increased is that some of the square footage, given the fact that the total of this new square footage is equivalent to the total of the old square footage, what is being increased is this roof area that's extended out. And going back to one of the first presentations I made, the idea was, if you're building a roof for a conditioned space, a workshop space, or a heated space, right? And you've already gone to all the effort for the structure, the columns and the beams here, it's very efficient to extend that roof out to create another covered area. We've increased the amount of covered area beyond what we currently have. Would it be nice to continue and increase that even further and stretch out that roof? Sure. In the same way that it'd be nice to have bigger courtyard. But we're trying to put restrictions on the staff to say, look, this is workable. This is enough square footage to get. To the point that we are saying to the staff, you need to work within these parameters. Because the office, well, Linda,
I'm sorry, Linda, but this conversation will
not
be. One question.
So, yes,
one more question. Why have there been so many refusals to put up story poles? I think story poles are extremely important to show people how big this facility, or how small this facility is. Why is everyone refusing to put up story poles? The answers are no, 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 no. Why? What's wrong with story poles?
Wouldn't one of the story poles be definitely in the middle of the path?
I'm sorry, what did you say?
Excuse me, I have
a hearing problem.
I know, but the way you're really asking is disrespectful. I can very easily speak louder if you ask me in a respectful way. I believe that one of the poles would be in the middle of the walkway, wouldn't it? Because when you look at it, how... You would be putting a pole here, right? You would be putting a pole here, and isn't it where the path currently leads? So if you would like to have poles in the middle of the path, I don't know if you do.
we could do that. Why, would that be amenable to you guys? To put up story poles for a week? How about for 1 week?
I think that they, well, again, my best shot. One of the significant things here, given that this has been talked about and it has been part of a long process that has looked at other locations, other ideas, other types of buildings, is that to a large degree, the district is confined to this site location, and for reasons of usability of the space, it's confined to having to have certain height minimums. So, you know, to that end, what's been done so far in terms of looking at this and looking at how low could the roof go and where could the footprint go, has been something that's just has been backed into that notion or that example or that that design. I have believed that to put story poles there would be misleading in that you've got the existing building still there, and it would be very misleading just to pretend as if this is, you couldn't even stand back far enough to be able to see the story pole in, for example, this corner relative to what happens when this building is gone. So it's, to me, the usefulness of doing story poles. Story poles usually are done when you have a situation where a condition exists, there's nothing there, and you're going to put up something to show that it's a blocked view or that it's a significant height change. You know, in this case, that is not typically why you would go to the extra extent of putting up story poles. So,
why can't you just put story poles up at the edges of the building? We can all figure out where the courtyard is.
Well, first of all, just so you know, and I've stood out there on the site with some residents, the height of the back of the building is actually at the same location and lower slightly than the existing trailer. So you don't need a story pole to see where this end is because it actually exists in reality. So
your answer is because they're misleading? Why can't we do it?
I see the point how it's, when you put a story pole now with the other buildings still present, it doesn't really reflect what the new building would look like in the new setting. I don't know.